Dear guests, dear comrades, it's a great pleasure for me as an individual who is professionally linked to the history of socialist Yugoslavia, as well as a representative of Rosa Luxemburg Stiftung from Belgrade, to open this first presentation of Mr. Darko Sovin's book SAMO, JEDNOM, LJUBI, Radiografija, SFRY Yugoslavia I 1945. do 1972. The subtitle of the study is more than programmatic, as it defines precisely what the book is about. It is about a hypothesis on the beginning, the end, and the essence of the period when socialist Yugoslavia was at its height. It is an attempt to overlook Yugoslavia and its problems as a historically and dialectically, namely contradictory journey. As the author points out, and in contradiction to the recent hegemonic perception, nationalism was surely not, at least for a long time, one of the vital questions or problems of socialist Yugoslavia. And on the point when nationalism became vital, it was first and foremost an expression of class necessities. The essays in this book tries to take the main contradiction of the Yugoslav social and economic life, a life between revolutionary disalienation of mankind and the repeated birth of alienation, the gap between an enormous emancipatory potential that was in the concept of worker self-management and that marked Yugoslavia to, as Frederick Jameson rightly said, valuable experience of the international left, and the creeping infirmity of the economic structure. To the contemptuous review of history that is unseen since the 90s, and that is currently continuing in a counter-revolutionary exhibition in the Historical Museum of Serbia under the title In the Name of the People, sets this book an evident contrariness. The Rosa Luxemburg Foundation is deeply committed to the goals of democratic socialism as recognition towards its namesake Rosa Luxemburg, who was murdered by counter-revolutionary and anti-democratic forces, as well as in favor of socialist Yugoslavia, which was, despite all its complexity, contradictions and reversals, a great attempt towards socialist democracy ventured under adverse historical circumstances. Rosa Luxemburg Stiftung is a left-oriented non-profit organization operating internationally for political education and which is affiliated with Germany's left party, Die Linke. The Office for Southeast Europe, located in Belgrade, supports non-profit organizations in the former Yugoslavia, in Albania, Bulgaria and Romania. One of our main goals is to contribute to the elaboration of a differentiated and critical discourse on the history of the left in the region. I'm sure that this book is a great step in this direction. Now I would like to introduce our speakers. First of all, the author Darko Sovin, an intellectual whose personal biography is as complex and interesting as the history of Yugoslavia. Born in Zagreb, he was a young theater critic. He was also part of the famous International Festival of Student Theaters located in Zagreb. He is one of the internationally best-known researchers on the great Bertolt Brecht, as well a well-known theoretician on science fiction literature and a lucid commentator of the post-Yugoslav period. Darko Sovin is professor emeritus of McGill University in Montreal. He studied in Zagreb, Bristol, Sorbonne and Yale. He was chief editor of two scientific journals, and he is author of 21 books and more than 600 articles. Darko, it is a great pleasure to have you here. Our second guest, to my right, is Boris Buden, philosopher and publicist from Zagreb, who currently lives in Germany's capital, Berlin, and who teaches at the Bauhaus University in Weimar. Boris was editor of the famous anti-war journal Axin, one of the most important documents of Croatian and Yugoslavian left war opposition during the beginning of the 90s. Recently, he is one of the most important intellectual activists dealing with questions of capitalist restoration, historical revisionism as an integral part of the transition ideology, and questions of the black wave cinema movement in Yugoslavia, for what he collaborates with Jeremy Zilnik. And last but not least, Marko Križan to my left from Ljubljana. Marko is a sociologist and PhD candidate at the Department of Sociology, Faculty of Arts at the University of Ljubljana. He works in the field of Marxian theory of value and class. He also translated Professor Suven's essay 15 Theses on Communism and Yugoslavia in Slovenian language, published in Bodet 2012. I'm further deeply thankful to our comrades from the Institute for Labor Studies and the Initiative for Democratic Socialism for making available this room here and for helping in several organizational challenges. At the end, just one advice regarding the availability of the promoted book. Everyone who is interested to get a copy has to fill in his home address into the list of participants, and Rosa Luxemburg Stiftung will send you a free copy as fast as possible. So, dear guests, dear comrades, thanks for your attention, and dear Darko, the floor is yours.
Uvod je radikasno. Uvod je na hrvatsko-srpskom ili kako god hoćete zvati taj jezik, a onda ću ja po engleski. Prvo moram zahvaliti Rosa Luxemburg Stiftung, mojim prijateljima i drugovima Borisu i Marku, isto tako Svetlani Slapšak i drugovima iz DPU na svim komentarima, materijalima, diskusijama, a i na ovoj organizaciji. Meni je jako žao, u stvari mi je krivo i bunio sam se da ne mogu ostati. Ja bih jako volio ostati. Ja se bavim klasama, ova knjiga se bavi klasama na sljedeća 2-3 dana, ali pošto ste vi izašli na internetu pre 3 dana, ja sam već imao dogovoren isto ovakvu prezentaciju 1. maja u Beogradu, a da sam znao 30 dana, bilo bi 4. maja i krivo mi je. A šta se može, i win sam, i lose sam. Ja sam za uvod napisao 19 teza, od kojih ću vam čitati 12-13, jer nemam vremena. Želim da budem ispod 30 minuta. U ovom handoutu imate naslove, a za one koje neću čitati, barem za neke, dao sam malo dulje sadržaje što se tiče samoupravljanja. To je duga priča koja ima 100 strana u knjizi ili više od 100 i molim, pročitajte knjigu. Brojevi u zagradama iza svake teze odnose se na strane ove knjige, ako vas zanima da provjeravate. Ova knjiga je collateral damage, kako se to veli na hrvatski, posteljna šteta. Mojih memoara jednog Skojevca koje sam počeo pisati negdje pred 6-7 godina. Izašli su 3 navrata u Gordoganu, to jest 3. izlazi sada nakon 18 mjeseci čekanja. To je nekakav jako dobar, ali puževski časopis u Zagrebu. Gordogan, a bit će valjda i knjiga za godinu i po ili tako nešto. To uglavnom se bavi mojim razdobljem mojeg života kao titoističkog aktivista od 45. do 65. I sjećajući se na to, na sreću imam u familiji 2 gospođe, moju mamu i moju suprugu, koje su sve te stvari čuvale i prenosile 2 puta preko oceana. Moje bilješke i teke i fotografije, pite Boga šta ne, ima masu toga. I shvatio sam da sa mog stanovišta to je počelo jako lijepo, a kako je moguće da je svršilo na najgori mogući način, ne? Ratom mini državica. To mi je bilo sasvim nejasno, ja nisam politolog, hvala budi Bogu, I niti sociolog, niti ekonomista. Ja sam naprosto, recimo, intelektualac koji je pročitao Marksa sa 15 godina, od 15. nadalje. I rekao sam si, otprilike kao Brehtov Galileo, ich muss es wissen, pa moram to shvatiti. Kak je to bilo moguće? Ja sam stvarno bio totalni idiot 20 godina ili je tu ipak bilo nešto? Thesis 1, 6 sentences in medias res. The basic question of exploitation of man by man in a system born of the socialist revolution is who disposes of the surplus labor. And behind this question, sooner or later, the even more fateful one arises, who in fact appropriates the surplus labor. Socialist commodity exchange is the basic dialectical contradiction valid for a given time in a transitional period between capitalism and communism. That's number two. Number three, the law of value and commodity production still bear within themselves the danger of some tendencies towards restoration. Number four, state socialism necessarily grows into privileged bureaucracy as a social parasite, the throttling of socialist democracy and the general degeneration of the whole system. And there comes about a restoration of a specific kind of vulgar state capitalist monopoly. Number five, without introducing workers' councils in each economic branch for the whole of Yugoslavia, at the same time centralized and democratic associations of the direct producers, the decentralization of operative management away from the state does not lead forward, but leads inexorably back to state capitalism. In fact, to several state capitalisms in the constituent republics, which would be particularistic in relation to the whole of Yugoslavia, and bureaucratic come centralist towards below in relation to the working collectives. Number six. The socialist democratic rights of the direct producers cannot be reduced to territorial self-government. That's the communes, commune. They are the obverse of the process of abolishing monopolies. Basic is the right of the working masses to self-management at all levels of socialist state power. These six sentences are not an outrageous invention of mine. They are slightly rearranged citations from Boris Kidrich between 1949 and 1952. The same view was later clearly formulated by Branko Horvat and strongly suggested by most Praxis collaborators. Thesis two, why write a book about Yugoslavia in what stands? The smothering hegemony of the counter-revolutionary age enforces a damnation of memory. The demeaning of all that was the case in SFRY, as I shall for brevity call the 1945 to 89 society. The repressed festers, it is needful to probe it. My first axiom is twofold. A critical overview of salient aspects of SFRY is urgently needed. A critical utopian horizon is a proper way to judge alienation and disalienation, or concrete dystopia and concrete utopia. The rulers tell us that was then, this is now. Contrary to all human, say cultural, and even biological continuity, this capitalist denial of all time, history, and tradition does not issue in and tradition that does not issue in profit now, leads to termination of many species, possibly including Homo sapiens, certainly including humanity and sapiens. The stance or approach must therefore be one of a political epistemology that radically doubts the enemy's classifying principles as an Epicure's swerve and Marx's resolute deviation. What does not have to be in the book? In an attempt at the first theory, only the long duration fateful aspects can be focused upon. The need for SFRY independence, Tito's great invention, as presupposition to any self-government is taken for granted. This book does not deal with the foreign relations of SFRY, including Tito's second invention of the non-aligned movement, nor with the strong pressures on SFRY from the Soviet Union and then the world capitalist market and its institutions. nor does it deal with nationalism, which become fateful only from the 1970s on, and then because of class necessities, as you've cited. Nor, regretfully, with religion, though I argue that matters of salvation and belief were at the core of SFRY. What has to be in the book? The categorical red thread is a use of Marxist concepts of alienation versus emancipation in permanent shuttle to and from SFRY economics, beliefs, and politics. Marx thought of this alienation as, and I quote, the absolute working out of people's creative potentialities, which makes the development of all human powers as such the end or in itself, end of quote. It is rendered possible by this alienation in economics, beginning with the abolition of private property over the means of production, but also by this alienation in politics. A central hypothesis of the book is that these two strands must intertwine as a double helix, on pain of infertility and collapse. This self-government of the producers is my concrete utopia. I hope you've read Bloch, so I don't have to explain what is concrete utopia. The strategic limitation in question. The thesis so far mean a strategic limitation of extensive analysis to the period 1945 or even 50 to 1972. After that, no new factors appear, only the old drawbacks get aggravated. The analyses are accompanied by hypotheses about the SFRY's essential tension, indicating this is one, by Kidrich, and about its beginning and end, as sufficient for this first attempt. The stance is one of looking backward from the mostly scandalous years 1972-89, and its fully scandalous downfall in the worst imaginable variant of a congeries of mutually embattled dwarfish classes leading brainwashed mini-nationalisms, which is what the book has to explain how come. Thesis 6. As Marx, I wish to proceed from classes as strategic nodes between the circulation of goods needed for life and everything else in the human production of life. They are subtended by an unequal appropriation of surplus labor. Class interests imply different orientations and personal motivations. These large groups of people depend from other groups in the amount of power they have, in the societal function, in economic position, and in other cultural practices in the reproduction of life. With these presuppositions, there was in SFRY a class spread, which was in 1971 composed out of a total of 20.5 million people of ruling class, 0.5 to 0.8 million. Various middle classes, 4.5 to 5.5 million. Statistics are all fuzzy. Peasant smallholders, 7.5 million, plus private artisans, 500,000. Manual workers in industry, transport, building services, around 7 million. The 1 million workers eventually abroad at that year were partly from this class and partly from peasantry. Since they were unequal in power, control of the conditions of production, material privileges, and collective consciousnesses, this is a class pyramid, albeit of recent formation after much upward mobility and counteracted by officially egalitarian and factually plebeian pressures. Distinct working class fractions emerged based on qualification, income, gender, and permanence of employment. Probably there were at least five. We have no work on that. The highly skilled workers, 9% by 1970, participated more actively in politics and self-management, while on the other end, the unskilled ones were more rebellious but less politically conscious and far less organizable. The unskilled and semi-skilled fraction in the middle, plus a growing number of semi-legal peasant workers in the 70s, 80s, comprised perhaps half of this class, the working class. And together with women workers, who were about 30%, probably three quarters. As to the middle class, their fractions went from the lowest of technicians and clerical employees to engineering, scientific, and humanist intelligentsia. The attendant major social shift in SFRY 1950 to 72 was the move of between 1.5 and 2 million peasants to the cities in an unstoppable tide. When in 69 the peasantry fell under 1/2 of the total population for the first time since the Neolithic, this was an epochal change. By the 80s, private peasantry seemed to have been less than 1/5 of the population, though many unskilled workers could return to the farm in crisis and did, I think. Another major social shift was the rapid mass production of the first modern proletariat and intelligentsia in this part of the world. So all of us are sons, grandsons, daughters, granddaughters of that. Finally, the source of sufficient capital accumulation was left unresolved. The rise and disposal of the surplus value arising from labor power, to be balanced between industrialization, defense, and standard, became a crux. It was the underlying locus of all achievements and discontents. The principal political contradiction after the first few years was, to my mind, one between the budding oligarchy and the self-government of the people. That is, who decides how and for what to use the accumulation or surplus value? A small part of the party tried to think about a disempowerment of oligarchy. But since the party's professional core, out of class interest, shied away from bottom-up democracy outside, it could not allow it inside either. An impasse resulted in the form of a veto power by the regional oligarchies, which became nationalist and chauvinist as against the federal power. The depth events below the historical flow can be illuminated as two groups of major SFRY singularities. Thesis 10, the singularities hypothesis. The first is a group of creative plebeian singularities. It began as a communist-led popular or plebeian revolution that created a strong partisan tradition of snagi se druže, applied both in the fighting units and in the network of territorial power and in the political organizations, all subtended by an in-depth experience of self-determination. It continued after 1944 as popular enthusiasm for reconstruction of a devastated but now liberated country. It culminated in the secession from Stalin and some top leaders' rediscovery of the Paris Commune and of their own partisan roots in Marxian self-rule, which led them to strengthen local centers of power down to the basic territorial units and to slowly introduce self-management in the nationalized enterprises with centralized but potentially supple planning in the Kidrich model. It established the horizon of ethnic fraternity and socialist democracy from below. This first group of singularities can be read as the Communist Party's historical bloc or tacit alliance with the plebeian classes forged at the end of the 1930s and during the Liberation War, diffusing fascist imperialism, bourgeois exploitation, and Stalinism. Its strongest bastion was to be found in the self-management system within production and services. In the 1960s, this was waning, while no possibility of open pressures by the plebeian classes within a socialist democracy was developed. The second is a group of suicidal class singularities caused by the consolidation of a ruling class that regrouped from the end of the 60s on as partly a financial technocracy and partly as three major and three or four minor ruling groups in the constituent republics, halting further emancipation of labor and of the public sphere, abolishing efficient planning, and introducing a slide towards nationalism. It held repressively together until the end of the Cold War. It can be read as stagnation and Yugoslav Brezhnevism, with loss of connection to mass energies from below, while the economy grew into a patchwork between a largely uncontrolled profit motive and consumer market, with an inefficiently decentralized command economy of the Soviet type, a patchwork. In an unfavorable international political and economic climate, it culminated as the split oligarchic classes became, as a rule, ready to turn into neo-comprador bourgeoisies at the service of foreign financial capital. I will skip now two theses, I believe, 17. The alternatives and the horizons. Due to the cultural and, economism dismantling planning. Market socialism was the minimum common denominator of an intra-oligarchy compromise as a minor evil compared to integral self-management and major loss of power. Self-management had vigorous root in the partisan movement and which routed the fascist invaders and brought the new society into being. Its strategy rise from the ranks. The partisan system was a self-management system applied to war. However, this alternative was rejected out of fear for the oligarchy's rule. The market was mystified as a socialist invisible hand and panacea, and ideologically twinned with crass economism that denied transparent politics in favor of oligarchic power, jettisoning central planning with feedback from lowest levels. It was forgotten that productive forces meant for Marx the sum total of the resources for liberation available to a given society. The ensuing course led to disaster. Lenin had concluded that in the socialist transition period, and I quote, there remains for a time not only bourgeois law, but even the bourgeois state without the bourgeoisie, underlined by him. Unquote. But if not vigorously counteracted, this means also we have learned the bourgeois economic framework without the bourgeoisie. The main lesson is that political and ideological emancipation is indispensable for a full reorganization of production in a socialist state, if you wish to call it that. Self-management in production and radical democracy are mutually dependent, covariant. Full economic democracy necessarily has to be accompanied by political democracy, a budding civil society within socialism, see Gramsci. And finally, alternatives and horizons. Yet, due to cultural and economic backwardness and to the absence of a rooted working class culture, the Yugoslav revolution was necessarily at least as much a bourgeois democratic as a proletarian one. It creatively fused the impulses and formulations of the French Revolution 1789-94 and of the Russian Revolution 1917-22 into an anti-fascist insurrectionary mold. It was a peasant revolution led by that combination of dissident intellectuals and internationalist working class traditions as channeled by Stalinism, which was the small but tight and rapidly expanding Communist Party of Yugoslavia and its youth wing SKOJ. Any worthwhile mode of living would have to be arrived at by doing after the revolution simultaneously the work of capitalism, insofar as a primitive accumulation to build up industry and tertiary services was quite indispensable, as well as the work of communism, by creating a new alloy of the ideological, the economic, and the political, a new unity of solidarity. The interests of the working people, I find in this book, are in the long run incompatible with the management of the economy dominated by reproduction of capital, and with the management of societal life dominated by secrecy and monolithism. However, the logic of collective action in favor of socialism in one country was opposed to the logic of capital internationally. Giving in to the second logic, in the last shameful 20 years of SFRY, instead of governmental guardianship over sectoral balance and infrastructural investments for sustained growth and declining class and regional inequality, plans and investments were oriented to the needs for foreign earnings and loans and projects with capitalist financing from abroad. The dismantling of the welfare state began in SFRY before the world capitalist offensive of the 1970s, but for analogous class reasons. But how was the first logic, utopian communism or radical emancipation, to be sustained in a world capitalist market? Decoupling from it would only have been possible with international support. It must be acknowledged that, in my opinion, a macro alternative to what SFRY descended into remains an open question. However, a chance of encountering stormy weather, as Horvat put it, with a firm and steerable ship was squandered by 1972. Thank you.
Dear Duncan, thanks for the concise thesis. Now our second speaker is Marco Krizan.
Thank you, Bruno. It is a privilege to be able to discuss a book like this, especially if it was written by an author like Marco Subin. I'm very glad that he was able to come to Ljubljana and Boris Bulen as well. Now, it is a privilege, but it's also very hard to add something to a study as thorough and substantiated as this one. But I have agreed to give it a try, so I will try to, based on my own much more modest research, to make 3 points in order to complement or to add something to what Darko said and especially to what he has written. The first point is about measuring or assessing the successes of Yugoslav self-management. As Darko already explicated, I also agree, it was up until mid-60s a successful social process, I would say. So what does this mean? I think it means overcoming of four central problems of Yugoslav society present at the moment of its founding in 1918 and formulated by Dušan Bilečić in his seminal work. The first one is overcoming of economic exploitation. The second one, overcoming of underdevelopment. The third, achieving national independence. And the fourth, national problem. Now, this national problem creates a paradox situation, at least according to Bilenčić. By 1918, Yugoslav nations were sort of accomplished modern nations, as he puts it, with a tendency to create their own nation states. On the other hand, though, their historical interest was to live in a common state. Now, Bilenčić is not very clear what this common interest was, but I think that it cannot be interpreted as a sort of ethnic and linguistic similarity, although such similarity exists, of course. The only proper historical interest stems from one common feature of those nations, and that was that they were all a periphery of larger and stronger states and commons, in this case, Austria and Hungary. And in my opinion, this meant that Yugoslav society was facing not only with the task of catching up with capitalist societies and, of course, promoting its national independence, but also it had to achieve that without reproducing relations of unequal development and political dependency between its various republics. Now, the result of my research is that until mid-60s, Yugoslav society was successful in overcoming or solving those problems. First of all, it was able to dismantle the class structure of pre-war Yugoslavia, replacing it with a much fluid structure that Darko very clearly analyzes in one of his chapters, a structure which enabled a very high upward mobility for the working people. Secondly, it managed to make a leap from rural to industrial society, as we've heard, with it was a remarkable achievement. In 15 years, it was a process that was completed that took, let's say, 40 years in Italy or 80 years in France and so on.
250 in England.
Yes. And the third point is that unlike the Kingdom of Yugoslavia, which was a dependent state in all its aspects, the Socialist Yugoslavia was achieved truly through independence and also played a part in the anti-imperial struggle of the non-aligned movement. And with regard to the fourth problem, this first period was the only period where there was some convergence in terms of GDP growth and the standard of life, of the living standard in Yugoslav republics.
So we all know that those favorable tendencies became interrupted and reverted later on, and this book gives some clues about why this happened. I'd only like to add 2 points, one being that this turning point was not only limited to socialist countries. We know that there were many developmental projects in South America, North Africa, Southern Europe, that also suffered stagnation. Maybe not as dramatic as Yugoslavia, but still. And secondly, I would also like to say that some positive legacies of that period have endured. Of course, they endured very unequally in geographical terms, but as far as Slovenia, for instance, is concerned, we know that the process of catching up with the West that was started in the early 50s went on with some interruptions in the 80s and 90s up until the present crisis, I would say. And things like full employment and social equality meant that that this growth has benefited the working people much more than in countries with capitalist social order. And even when the system went down, it remained more beneficial for the working people than comparable capitalist systems. Okay, let's move to the second point. As was also mentioned, and is clearly analyzed in the book, every socialist state faces or faced the problem of underdevelopment, and that's why it had to rely on some form of primitive socialist accumulation. Namely, the orderly accumulation of nationalized economy was not sufficient for catching up. And there were two ways to solve this problem which were proposed in the USSR. You know that Preobrazhensky proposed a sort of unequal exchange between the state and the private, mostly agricultural sectors, and that that sort of trade surplus, which would be created by the state sector in this unequal exchange, would allow it to employ more workers and capital to ensure faster growth. Stalin, on the other hand, had the idea that collectivization of agriculture will create the necessary surplus by raising productivity in the agricultural sector. Now, Yugoslav leadership wanted to avoid both those options, and it came to rely on foreign accumulation in the form of financial aid and credit. And of course, although the access to credit was to a certain extent made possible by the contenders between the two blocs, it also made the country vulnerable or exposed to fluctuations in external balance of power, which was increasingly unfavorable. But again, this was not something that happened only to socialist countries. It is a process common to almost every other development project of those times, and which created two problems. You know? On the one hand, you had access to credit, which was dependent on the global financial sector, which you could not control, and this triggered numerous debt crises, like the ones we have recently saw in Portugal, Greece, Slovenia, if you want. But the deepest crisis came when the external and internal factors combined. Because it's not only that the economy runs out of fuel from time to time because the credit stops, but also that the investment financed by credits are inefficient. And this is one of the darkest points, and this is also brings me to my final point, the inefficiency of let's say, macroeconomic coordination of socialist systems as such. Branko Horvat, who was also mentioned, brilliantly defined the intention behind the self-management. He said, if you want true self-management, then it is not enough for the workers to manage the firms. The firms themselves have to have enough autonomy to make their decisions, otherwise the workers' management is a farce. So the firms must be independent from the planning organs, and their mutual relations must be regulated by something other than plan, and that was market. And that's why Yugoslav socialism was market socialism. Because you see, in capitalism, capital hires workers to produce profit. Firms are supposed to maximize profit rate, we all know that. And wages are only a cost that has to be minimized. And when workers take charge of their firms, this capitalist relation gets turned around. Because instead of capital hiring workers, workers hire the capital, or if you want, the means of production. And what they maximize is not profit, but that part of the new value added which accrues to them, so the former wage. And what, the part that used to be profit becomes the rent paid by the workers for the use of social capital. And this is a cost that the workers try to minimize. So, you know, in capitalism you have a profit, which is potential accumulation and new investment. And because the imperative of running a business and investing is maximizing this profit, you have a system that has a built-in mechanism of potentially unlimited accumulation. However, in a self-management economy, the immediate aim of production is not accumulation, it is maximization of workers' income. And instead of two classes performing two opposite functions in their own class interest, you know, capitalists are accumulating, of course, in their own interest, and workers are trying to enlarge their income in all their own interest, you have one in socialism, one social group that that is the working people that have to perform both those functions. And socialism cannot reproduce itself without a sort of a mechanism, let's call it planning mechanism, which ensures a proper rate of accumulation for each sector and for the economy as a whole. Because workers of a particular firm can maximize their income as they please, as long as they are able to pay this rent for the use of social capital. Now, this is the concept of social property, also one of the important inventions of Yugoslav socialism. The workers, as members of wider economic units, such as sectors or national economies, have to be able to impose to themselves, as members of commodity-producing firms, some sort of rational norms of accumulation and also of investment. So to do that, they have to build a sort of proper knowledge and certain social institutions. I think this is very important because this split between the partial and common interests of the workers is characteristic for all socialist projects, be it market socialism or totally planned socialism. And as Darko rightly points, and I will stop here, the economic system which was created, let's say, by Kidrich was the right step towards solving this problem. And this system also had a potential for so-called spontaneous, let's say, development. And moreover, there were people like, for instance, Slovenian economist Lipovec, whom Darko also cites in his book, who have demonstrated that this system of Kidrich could evolve or be transformed into a system of rationally planned accumulation and investment. Now, despite the fact that ultimately Yugoslav socialism hasn't established such a system, it gives us a clue, I think, of how it can be done. It can be done. And I think this is the invaluable core of Darko's book and of his method. You must not forget why it went, what went wrong and why it went wrong, but on the other hand, you also have to remember how it could have gone right. Or as Boris had put it at the back of the book, napred sjećajući se.
Thank you, Marko, for your comment, and now it's Boris' turn.
Yes, this was Brecht. Brecht, do you hear me?
Yes. Yes.
Brecht is very interesting for me because he was very skeptical about the past. He even had this idea that you know, we should thinking of being able to erase the traces. This is also what Walter Benjamin quotes. It's about being able to liberate oneself from the past. So, for me, I won't catch up with what you have been talking in the same way, tackling the content of the book, the problem, the past as given. Because I think there is, it's like, you know, sort of jumping the gun. I think it's a general problem or a trouble with the past, with how to deal with the past. This book and this this big try, I say try, it is try to in a very, I dare to say, old-fashioned, which is not a critique, old-fashioned, modernist, even historian in terms of history as objective knowledge on the past, based on facts. It's an attempt to open a perspective to the past and to reactivate it. But I think that the time we live in, the age is not welcoming such an try. This is, you know, although this is the time that is obsessed with the past, that is, as Pierre Nora, French historian, would say, we live in the age of commemoration, in the time when memory has replaced what once was called history. And there is a what first came to my mind thinking about this book about the Yugoslav past is another book, David Loventhal's, a seminal book on cultural heritage, and it's a beautiful title which is taken from a novel of L.P. Hartley's novel "Go Between," and it reads: "Past is a foreign country. They do things differently there." Which you see, the past is today perceived mostly in terms of cultural difference. It's foreign country, and of course, past is something that is present. It's not. They did things differently there. They do things differently there. So it is the presence of the past or the pastness of the past. Both are open possibilities. And such this book, Darko's book, is a challenge for us. A challenge in terms that we are to decide, not only reading this book, but facing the problem of the presence of the past or the pastness of the past. We are to decide what is the past, what is the present. This is still what is open. At the same time, I repeat, in the time that is obsessed in a fetishistic way with past as a cultural other, it is extremely difficult to reclaim it from this cultural otherness, to reclaim it as a political motivation. As you have been mentioning, and this is what Marco also stressed, it is what to take from this past, what not to take, how to learn from the past. This is, as we know, a big problem. Historia est magistra vitae is a very old Cicero's proverb, well-known Cicero's proverb, but Gadamer translates this historia as a memory. It's about memory of, so history, is able to teach us only if it is a lived history, or only if it is a memory of those who were there or have heard the story about what really happens. This has changed in modernity. History has become the space of experience, not simply a story, but completely open, has become a subject, as we know, with revolutions. And this is not only the book about the past, it is the book about the past in which history was the subject, in which history was acting on a stage and was not, as Fukuyama later says, wrote precisely, or I think it's 25 years ago, precisely 25 years ago, that this is how he ends his essay on the end of history, putting history in the museum and understanding the task of generations to come in terms of taking care of the history in the museum. This is completely different idea. So I'm just trying to share this problem of how to deal with history, with the past, how to learn from it. For me, the most precious moment in this book is something that I would rather explain, not in terms of differences, especially not in terms of cultural differences, but in terms of certain continuities, in terms of the sameness between the present and the past, or the presence of the past, or one could even say it is not about past being present now, it is about our present being able to recognize itself in a continuity, in this past. I remember as Srećko Puljik came from Zagreb, he will remember that at the beginning of the 80s we organized at the Faculty of Philosophy in Zagreb a sort of revolt against, at that time it was the so-called school reform by Stipe Šuvar, a theorist, one of the theorists of Yugoslav socialism. Few years ago, the students in Zagreb occupied again the faculty, not only in Zagreb. You probably remember this very important event. What was for me a striking moment is to recognize that the cause is the same. It was a revolt against commercialization or commodification of education. So, 81, 82, we were revolting against the commodification of education, and 20 years later, more than 20 years later, people were revolting against the same problem. There are certain continuities. There are certain, and what Marco also says, you know, it's not about the ideology of post-communist transition that is based on the idea of the catching up with the West. The catching up with the West, the process of catching up, is a long-term process, obviously. And it is a part of the Yugoslav past, and there are certain what is really precious about the book is, and people mostly don't do it. They don't read these facts, these documents. They don't read Kardes and Bakarić's and Šuvar's and etc. etc. Now in the book, you are somehow you cannot avoid reading it. And these are these beautiful continuities. I have chosen few of them just to show you how one can catch up in terms of continuity, catch up with the past in terms of similarities, in terms of same problems, of same struggles. Like, you know, like Kardel writing at the beginning of the 60s, this is from your book, I took it from the book. He writes, "We are against the state paternalism, a good government that takes care of a good but stupid people. Our goal is to establish the material conditions and democratic forms in which working people can take care of themselves." One can read it with the experience of a neoliberal capitalism also as an early, you know, socialist try to catch up with neoliberal transformations, anti-etatist transformations. As you know, the reform of education at the end of the 70s and the beginning of the 80s was based on the idea that the state should retreat from financing culture and education. This was the major idea, and that the subjects of the economy at that time, which was market economy, should take care of it. This is not so far away from what we from our actual experiences. Just to the beginning of the 70s, at the party Congress 71, the elite becomes aware of party elite of the problem. I quote, "The surplus value taken from the state didn't return to production, that is to the organizations of self-management labor, but flowed over to the banks, insurance and large trade companies, especially those in export branch. The major social conflict is now defined officially at the Party Congress 71 as economic and political conflict between the centers of economic and financial power that seized monopoly and made themselves, I quote, autonomous on the one side and the self-management labor on the other side." So you see the growing financial, the power of the financial capital growing within this socialism. I remember also where how I was, I couldn't believe when Zelimir Žilnik, the director, told me that his film, Early Works, that was made 68, was actually financed by a loan, bank loan. It was the bank loan. This says, and usually in the totally culturalized discourse on the cultural past, nobody asks who paid for the film, for the production, how cultural industry was working. 90% of people working in the cultural industry and producing films, and it was powerful film industry being able to produce 30 features films a year. Almost 95% of those people were precarious workers, non-employed, working on the market, same as today, free lands, laborers, which is the 60s. And what you get instead, this is this post-totalitarian story, well, in this system, ideological system, there was no freedom for art, So, and people believed that state financed and controlled everything, and taking this example of early works, early works, saying yes, and the film was forbidden. Well, the fact is that before it was how we at the time they said bunker put in a bunker, bunkeriran, that it paid back six times the loan, the money that was invested in the film. So these are elements that are completely, I wouldn't say forgotten, they are suppressed and excluded from the past as it is remembered today. So these are a few elements, and just to say, as to quote one more, like for instance, Bakarić, who in this, at the beginning of the 70s, write that the major problem lies in the capital that is accumulated in the banks, that is autonomous, out of any control, this is a quote, out of any control, and that capital that restores capitalist relations and conditions wherever it occurs, and it occurs everywhere. This is the beginning of the 70s. We see how party struggles with the power of financial capital. The beginning of the 70s, former Yugoslavia has still $1 billion debt. 73 is the oil crisis. At the end of the decade, Yugoslavia has a $20 billion debt. And at the beginning of the 80s, IMF and World Bank intervene in former Yugoslavia, and Yugoslavia is the member of these international capitalist institutions from the 50s. And at that moment, as you know, the wages were frozen in former Yugoslavia, but it was not the dogmatic ideology of communists, it was what happened to Greece. It was the pressure under the pressure of the IMF, International Monetary Fund. So this is a past we can directly connect to the situation of Greece yesterday or Croatia tomorrow. This is why I believe that Darko's book is important, because it puts us into this situation of responsibility for a decision, what to identify with, what is the present, past, and it is our responsibility. I'm generally skeptical. It is so much work, critical work needed, that the reception of this book gives results, that the precious content consisting of facts, ideas of what is really good to be not remembered and taken from the past, that this is still a big challenge. Darko is an old modernist, humanist, universalist, and probably it is not only that he belongs to the past. It is probably that the past, through Darko's book, wants to reconnect with the future. And but the readers are those asked to do this job of collection. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, Boris. Now I would propose that Darko gets a chance to have a comment on both speeches, and after that I will open the floor.
Well, it is in a way strange to discuss with Marko Krđan and Boris Buden, because they are among the three or four people, including two American ladies, Susan Woodward and Ellen Comiso, from whom I learned most for this book. In a way, I have to say that our starting point, I'm not sure about our horizons, possibly largely our horizons also are more or less very near. They belong to the same family, as Wittgenstein would say. And I won't comment on this, okay? I agree, and that's it. Yes, sorry, did you hear this?
No.
Yes, okay. I will therefore, for economy's sake, concentrate only some things where I'm not sure that I agree with the comment, or I'm not sure where the comment is, what the comment is getting at. I am strongly skeptical about Dušan Bilandžić. Dušan Bilandžić, who has great deserts as a pioneer of history of Yugoslavia, simply because there was nobody else before him who had access to documents. He was a member of the Bakaric clique. He was a member of the Croatian oligarchy, staunchly anti-federalist, okay? And as far as this could have been said in the 80s, which was not too far, but it was far enough. his theoretical basis is, if you wish to say exiguous, I would say more precisely non-existent. He's a pragmatist. He's a leading party member who turned to writing history. What was the nation's self-interest? Well, of course, to be independent, to determine their development themselves, and not French banks or English banks or German banks or Austrian banks or the American army or the Russian army or the Russian secret police or whatever. Which I think Marko said. This is, I think, entirely independent of any perspective of Bilandžić's and so on. I don't wish to be thankless. I have read four or five books by Bilandžić, and from a couple of them I learned. He was the first one to publish tables of economic stuff in a historical perspective. Of course, the economists like Horvath did it before him and better than him, but not in a historical perspective, unless they were also economic historians, as Horvath was. I will say very little about accumulation. Just a fact. We now have the facts of Stalinist accumulation in the 30s. You know that the historical role of Stalin was to have built the heavy industry which helped Russia to defeat Hitler. That was his historical positive role. I think you'll find very few people who hate Stalin more than me. But in the interest of historical truth, this must be said, okay? How did this happen? By exploiting mercilessly both the peasants and the workers. Victor Serge, who is the best source for all of that before we get to the archives of the Central Committee after 89, estimates, and everybody who's interested in that should read Victor Serge, he's now largely in English, but of course mostly in French, estimates that the real wage of Russian workers in 1938 was half of that in 1928. Where did the other half go? Building the industry. Ditto for the kolkhoz peasants, whose income was half of that of the peasants during the NEP. Where did the rest go? Well, into the industry. does that justify killing 2 or 3 or 4 or 5, I don't know how many million people? Of course it doesn't. The collectivization was done in the worst possible way. The demoralization of working class was done in the worst possible way. But nonetheless, that was the factual situation. And that is a dilemma of any socialist country, for example, Cuba, which doesn't have Venezuelan oil at its back. Russia has its own oil, okay. We see that it's not quite enough, even for 1/6 of the world, okay. Plan or market? I argue in this book that this is a totally false dilemma. This is, number one, a capitalist anti-planning dilemma, and number two, a Stalinist anti-market dilemma, okay? Do I agree with intellectually or like emotionally either? No, I don't. So I think it's false. What one needs, what Kidrich understood in 1950, is a market. And by the way, Trotsky also in 1930s, much before him, but of course he wasn't read. A market which acts as a corrective to a planning happening in democratic feedback between the federal centers and the working collectives, for which institutional forms must be found. Okay, so that workers' representatives are, in fact, in the ministry planning it. Okay, so this seems to me, practically, pragmatically, politically, a huge problem. Theoretically, no problem at all. This is just misinformation and ideology. Okay. Again, I have learned from Marco a lot of what he said now, just from what he has written so far, which I got sometimes in handwriting, you remember? Okay. Boris Budin, my great hero of anti-Tudjmanist resistance.
I was not so anti, I was anti-bourgeois class, which was not...
No, that was in the 80s. What I'm speaking about is the 90s, okay. In the 80s, I didn't know what you did, and you haven't published a book about it, so I don't know. Sorry. The past. Well, first of all, I'm a modernist. Yes, of course I'm a modernist. You want me to be a postmodernist? This is right. I mean, in fact, I don't believe something like postmodernism exists. I believe that postmodernism is the... In to a major part a degeneration of high modernism and to a minor part an innovation within high modernism. And this is a mirage, created by an ideology which says, to which the greatest historian of the 20th century succumbed, Eric Hobsbawm, when he wrote a book going from 1917 to 1989, okay? His last book about the 20th century history ends. So, 20th century is the rise and fall of Leninism, basically, for Hobsbawm, who was a Leninist, by the way. Impenitent Leninist who never left the Communist Party. But this, to my mind, is a little bit too simple. It's a beautiful book. Everybody should read it. Everybody should read the whole of Hobsbawm, if you have time and money. So, I think what modernism opened, what is modernism for me? Modernism for me, I start from literature, okay? Modernism for me is Kafka, Joyce, Dos Passos, Brecht. Modernism is Ford, Lenin. Lenin was a Fordist, of course, a communist Fordist. He wanted production. Okay, you want mass production, etc., etc. Einstein, Eisenstein. Okay, this is for me modernism. Our age doesn't welcome it. Well, so much the worse for all of us. yes, of course, you're right. that means we should agree with the agent? No, of course not, because you wouldn't have written this beautiful blurb if you agreed to that. The past, yes, of course, that from probably the shamans of the cave age, except we don't have their writings, but certainly from the first Chinese, Indian and Greek historians, such as Thucydides, etc., this is a conundrum. What is the past? Okay? What is time, asked Augustine of Hippo. If you don't ask me, I know it. If you ask me, I don't know it. Okay, what is the past? The past is a segment of time situated. Is it a space? No, it isn't. This is a false metaphor. Okay? The past is Africa, the present is Europe, the future is China. No, it isn't a space. Okay? If it is true that the past is Africa, it's for other reasons. If it is true that Europe time was the present, it's for other reasons, not because it was a space, but because it developed an industry, because it developed a navy, because it developed certain bourgeois democratic forms, because it had revolutions. Did India have revolutions? Well, not after Buddha. Okay? There was a counter-revolution when they kicked the Buddhists out. Does anybody know what the past is? No, not in that form that I know, anybody that I have read. What I do know, that the past is an imaginary construction. That is to say, where does it exist? It exists here. When does it exist? It exists now, or it doesn't exist at all. It exists at the time of any historian writing in the class ideology, if you wish to talk that way, of that historian writing, and it is therefore an interpretation of certain data which can be interpreted, as in all science, if you read the historians of science, the data do not determine a theory. Okay? A theory is underdetermined by the data, any scientific theory in the world. Okay? So is a fortiori, even more so, so is it the case outside of natural sciences, okay, in so-called human sciences, if you want to call them. So therefore, if the memory is present, then it is a struggle in the present. And if you wish to call it a class struggle in the present, who am I to disagree? About the present. In other words, I told you my personal psychological little reason for writing this book, you know. Can I justify myself to myself? Can I justify? It's like Milton in The Paradise Lost. Can you justify God to man? Okay, communism was our God. All right? Can it be justified? The problem is that if you are not religious, if communism is and is not a religion, dialectically, yes in some ways, but very much no in other ways, but very much yes in some other ways, then it is a dialectically contradictory, internally contradictory belief, if you don't like the word religion. I don't care. And you have to say, which Milton couldn't say, I accept half of God, but I don't accept the other half. I can say it. Okay? But that is not very important, except as my personal justification. The basic reason for this book is that I thought it might be of some use today. This is, I think, where Boris's skepsis comes in. Will it be of some use? Well, I have no idea. This is out of my hands. This depends on you, dear people. I don't know. It is possible that Rosa Luxemburg will distribute gratis 600 copies, of which 300 will not be read, 250 will be read badly, and 50 will be thrown into the wastebasket. I don't know. I mean, on the other hand, it is possible that three or four people might write beautiful things pointing out where I was wrong, which would please me no end, if they do it intelligently, and where I was right, which would please me even more, of course, if they do it intelligently. Let me just say one thing where I'm not quite sure that I get Boris's drift, which is also Rastko Močnik's drift, this neoliberalism in Kardel and the general drift in the 70s towards subcontracting and of course in culture towards. This is a half-truth, very dangerous, because they cannot be seen readily as lies, but they're of course not true. This is a period of degeneration where I come from, okay? In ideology and politics, in the rise of banks uncontrolled from below, you know? The banks had a workers' council. You know what the workers' council and the banks did? They discussed how much the office workers were paid. That's it. Had no influence at all on the bank's policy. The banks were founded by, I forget, 20 or 30. They had to have 20 or 30 founders, either territorial units or economic units. Yes, but the 20 or 30 founders had votes like the actioner in capitalism. That's fine, that's okay. The problem is that the banks gave loans to those 20 or 30 people and said, if you don't vote for me, you're not going to get this loan. Okay? Why? Because there was no feedback from below in the state planning system. So when the state, the central state, not the Republican states, which went on to become governments, okay? When the central state left the scene, so to speak, it didn't dispense money and accumulation anymore. It is not that the civic interest and the working class interest had organizational forums to say, we disagree with Comrade Zhilnik, but he points out some things we should know, which would be the proper response in my mind, you know. So we shall finance it. You have to finance your own opposition. What is socialism for if it doesn't finance? It's only loyal opposition, just like the capitalists do. We're much more clever. Più furbi, say the Italians, more. So the state should retreat from financing societal life. I agree 100%. Does that mean there should be no financing of societal life? I disagree 100%. In other words, what I'm saying, there is a third way. In Latin, tertium datum. Okay, there is a third way. There was a third way which was tried most imperfectly in Socialist Federative Republic Yugoslavia. But it left us, how should I say, a vector towards the horizon. That was what I was trying to say.
Dear Darko, thank you very much. So now I would like to open the floor. So if anyone has a question, please raise up your hand.
Okay. Yes, thank you. Is this working? No, a little. Thanks for all the presentations. You know, also, I've been reading a few parts of Darko's book already before, so I was already at that point very grateful to get this rich material. Now I would like to give each of you one short comment. First for Boris, this was also already a little bit touched by Darko. I think that one should be careful in drawing analytical distinction between post-Fordism and neoliberalism. I would agree with you that at certain point, like late 60s, 70s, there was a move towards, and there is this existence of this plural, flexible, let's say also employment and so on and so on. But I would disagree that we can read already that some kind of neoliberalism avant la lettre or something like that. This is Johanna Bokman's book is trying to do this, precisely this reading of economic theory, how on the West neoliberals took out from the self-management and the critique of the state and so on and so on. So, but this could be maybe argued in terms of theory, economic theory, but I think that in terms of political economical process, we should be a little bit more careful, or to say it in the other way about the catching up and stuff like this metaphor. In socialism, it wasn't just a dream to catch up with the West, but it was a part of the real like kind of progress. There is a certain material progress, and I would agree that until 65 and even later, you would have a certain material conditions for this catching up. Once we come to the capitalism or this restructuration in the 80s and then in the 90s progressively, we cannot dream anymore about catching up with the West. We are more and more dependent of the West and capitalism. And even the West in itself is split and is not catching up. It has dropped out of this enlightenment metaphor of the progress and so on and so on. So this is like one point maybe for the discussion. The other about Marco, I agree. When you were saying, well, quite in ideal terms about the maximization of the wage, or that could be a problem, the other side, like, of strengthening just the work part within the socialist enterprise, let's say. But when this happened in the reality, 60s, 70s, and here, I think, you know, also very well, Susan Woodward's thesis is quite correct to say that once this started happening, we had more and more unemployment, or in other words, the enterprises didn't allow new workers to be employed, so to speak. So you have this kind of inherent tension within this. And about the split within the working people, what you said, I think here I would be more, let's say, Althusserian, or would have more the definition of the class struggle that is preceding the classes, so to speak. Working people as such, if it is ideal category, and I agree that you don't have like two classes, like in capitalism in the same way, but I think also in parts of Darko's book there is this move towards understanding the ruling class, the formation of the ruling class, which late 60s, 70s was some kind of class compromise between bureaucracy, technocracy, and so on. So this could be one also interesting thing to maybe comment on or something. And for Darko, one of the things what we were now discussing also about the modernism, postmodernism, degeneration, and so on, I think that one thing that I really appreciate about it, but would be eager to hear a little bit more, is that there was some kind of inherent tension between, on the one side, let's say, revolutionary time, what you were saying about the partisans or the breakup with Stalin. There is certain kind of stopping of the capitalist temporality or kind of this anti-imperialist struggle on the one side, but at the same time, right, there was this push towards a very different temporality, which kind of equated revolution with economic modernization. And this is basically one split, or here what you also talk about, some kind of productivist dogma that industrialization will take care of everything. But then in 65, I agree there are a lot of different things, not just like plan, market, of this financialization and the integration to the West, but also kind of defeat of this model of economic modernization will take care of it. So I think that you are already pointing out to certain things there, like about the split of these temporalities. Maybe you can comment more.
Comment or other questions?
Disagreements.
Or comments?
Or disagreements?
Disagreement.
Thank you for this presentation. I would like to point to some other qualities of this book which were not mentioned, and I consider them extremely important, being more on the literary than on the sociological side, and more on the anthropological than philosophical side. And that is that this is a very unique phenomenon. And in fact, if you revise publishing about Yugoslavia in the last 20 years, 25 years, since it doesn't exist anymore, it's almost all of it is a tidal wave of superficial and really flat and banal thinking about the decomposition and so on and so on. There are very, very few works which are analytical. And in my view, this is maybe the unique critique of Yugoslav communism, critical work on Yugoslav communism that we have till now. So I see the excellence of this book, not only in that aspect, but also in the fact that it represents a genre singularity. It is a discourse which is quite unique and doesn't correspond with any of our academic models, which I appreciate very much, meaning very simple that it's never boring. Mm-hmm. The other thing about this book, it's encyclopedic in the sense not of modern encyclopedia, but in the sense of French encyclopedia. It's a free flight of the mind, and it's based on an enormous erudition, which is another rarity which we don't encounter very often in today's academic discourse. So these qualities, which are really unique, and, well, we could say very European in the core, would be the qualities that I really like to underline in this book. By reading it's some parts and reading now a book, very hastily, but I enjoyed it very much. I found the material which would be a basis for some anthropological debates which could be developed. And there are many, many levels from which you can start very specific research. So my intervention there would be few questions which rise from the book and from the debate. And one of them is certainly the fact that the invention of Yugoslavia was not based on concordance of ideas and political concepts, but it was also based on work of intellectuals and artists which imagined a completely different Yugoslavia. And the idea of Yugoslavia, as it was imagined in Vienna before the First World War, was not the Yugoslavia of similarities, the peoples that are similar. On the contrary, the idea was the Yugoslavia state of people who are different in language, in culture, and in the past. That was the idea of Yugoslavia. And when you think about the early ideas about the Yugoslav arrangements, the spatial and governmental arrangements, one of the ideas that emerged from these debates in Vienna were the so-called Turkish urbanism, which for one of the thinkers would serve as the base for spatial governmental arrangement of New Yugoslavia.
Who was that?
Milan Budimir. He published that also. He was from the core group of Yugoslav inventors, including Meštrović and others, and Dimitri Mitrinović and others in Vienna, and Anica Savić-Rebac, whom we mentioned yesterday. The other thing is that if we make this really, really clever parallel, witty parallel between Stipe Šuvar and Bologna process, we should think about the basic difference, and that is that we hated Stipe Šuvar, and I remember that very, very clearly, because of the technocratization of the university, not because of the problems or the financial invention which is at the core of the Bologna process. The Bologna process at the beginning, and I was present there in the debates, was the idea that all the European citizens should have a free access to study, including the PhD. That was the primary idea. It really evolved into something completely different, which we know now. So this parallelism should be really explored even more. The other thing is that I would like to suggest as a topic of debate is, if the Yugoslav socialism was a kind of singularity, as we all agree, wouldn't then we consider the case of Greece as an irregularity. Greece was ready to go into socialism, maybe more than Yugoslavia in 45. But unfortunately, it was decided otherwise. So all the irregularities that happened in Greece, including military coup, fascism in different forms, monarchy, really, really perverse monarchy, and finally, what is going on in Greece in the last, let's say, 10 years, is the consequence of the fact that Greece was not allowed to go into socialism. So we could really watch, research the Yugoslav socialism as a kind of mainstream idea, and even with a larger horizon that is mentioned here. And the third one, among parallels, among the awkward possibility of reading communist authors, which is probably one of the most boring activities that anyone could imagine, decoding their wooden language that was not understandable even at the time they were speaking publicly. There are some events, some moments which really deserve a second analysis. For instance, after 68 and 71 in Croatia, Croatian communists, that is the Croatian communist nomenklatura, in fact had a brilliant idea to promote feminism as a possible intellectual, philosophical, sociological remedy for nationalism. They started to finance the feminist publication since 69. They published, they introduced the teaching of feminism and feminist theory at the University of Zagreb since 71. They, in fact, promoted the whole thing with the congresses in Dubrovnik and so on and so on. And at the same time, the Serbian communists, not having a similar problem, went on with the complete exclusion of feminism. And, well, you know, there's a problem with Serbian culture too, and production of some Serbian films, especially the Black Wave films. And I would remind you that the early works by Zilnik ends with the execution of the only woman in the group who decided to continue her revolutionary work among the people. And the guys killed her. So, and the whole Black Wave was organized about the basic therapy of women who are, in fact, responsible for communism. So let's think about these aspects.
So, thank you. Svetlana, a comment on this comment, or should we maybe one further question? Because the catering service is waiting, so we can take a further question and a comment maybe on this question, and then I will introduce Mayday School, and our comrade Anne would give further information about the Mayday School. That will be from tomorrow until May, the 3rd of May. So. Is there any question or comment? So it's not. So I would ask Anne to come here and
so if I'm allowed.
Comments.
Ah, yes.
Can you wait 5 minutes?
Yeah.
Yes. So Darko has a comment, and after Darko is Anne's turn.
Well, about Gal and Svetlana and so on. Just a few words. In some place, when debating sukob na ljevici, the conflict of Krleža with the party literature in the 30s, which was reactualized 30 years later at some conferences, and in some places Bakarić comments on this, saying. Bakarić was a good friend of Ivan Supek, the minor brother of Rudi Supek, who told him about modern physics. Okay, he financed his Encyclopedia Moderna and so on, and I knew Ivan Supek very well. Bakarić writes our party was very provincial. We didn't know anything about Copenhagen physics. Our party in the 30s was very provincial. What I knew was Marx, Engels, Social Democratic Party, Lenin, Stalin, and what Marx, Engels, Lenin, and Stalin knew of science and humanities. Okay? That is very considerable from Lessing to Gorky, excuse me. That is not to be sneezed at, but it is not enough. So there would be a lot of mental hygiene necessary to clean up their vocabulary, catching up. This is Stalin's idea. We have to catch up. You want to catch up with America, and you are saying to everybody that America is a goddamn capitalist exploiting country. You see the unconscious coming out in this language. So the whole idea of catching up is ludicrous. Socialism is not catching up. Socialism is replacing. In order to replace, you must eat and have a house, and you must have an industry to produce food and houses. And if necessary, even motorcycles. I'm not sure about cars. So, anthropology and temporality, of course, is vaših usta u Božje uši. I didn't have time. Of course, I think of myself as a, how should I say, wild anthropologist. Mm-hmm. No? But for the present purposes, I prefer to call it political epistemology. You know, I really don't care what you call it. And the questions of temporality in a mental hygiene become absolutely paramount. What kind of time is it? We have to read Benjamin. Is it the spatialized time which advances further and further the progress time? No, it could be spiral time. Hegel has spiral time. Excuse me, Marx has spiral time. It could be all kinds of time. There is a wonderful book by George Gurbich on the sociology of time. He has about 15 times. Mm-hmm. You know, the peasants have the cyclical time. It is tied to classes, by the way, in Gurbich, who was Menshevik, but still he learned something. I didn't say, Svetlana, I would never say that Yugoslavia was a singularity. I said that inside Yugoslavia there were two singularities, a plebeian liberatory group of singularities, such as the NOB, blah, 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 the break with Stalin, samoupravljanje. And the second group, which was suicidal and ended as we know. But if you tell me that this book is a genre singularity, I love you even more than before, of course it is. I wish to relate to you about the Communist Party of Yugoslavia. I write a lot, and I will write a lot more. I write a lot in here. I didn't talk about it. We had a discussion with Boris when he came here, and he said, incidentally, about other things, in the Communist Party of Yugoslavia, there was a much more wider spectrum of opinions and positions than in all the parties in ex-Yugoslavia together today, from so-called left to so-called right. They were the quasi-fascists, there were in the party, only they were patriots and they got taken up by the struggle, you know. There were the anarchists, of course there were the anarchists, you know. I'm kind of half an anarchist. Although I think we need a party, okay. Some kind of, so, Anei, go on. And the parallel with Greece, by the way, is an absolutely correct parallel. The question which I put to myself after Yugoslavia collapsed was all the blood between 1941 and 45 justified? Or were the people who swore by Maček and Draža and said, let's wait, let the English come in, much less Croatian, Serbian, whatnot, blood will be spilled? Maybe yes, But then after that, 10 years after that, much more. And you would have had the same war as in Greece with English tanks. You would have had the Russian tanks. You would have had the Eam Elas fight. And you would have absolutely so. I don't think the argument about spilling blood is a strong argument. It is not to be sneezed at, excuse me. That means millions of killed and maimed people, suffering, families, tortures. It's a strong argument if you are a socialist, humanist, or any kind of thinking being. Okay? But it is simply wrong. And you can see that it's wrong because it's falsified by Greece. That's absolutely correct. Thank you.